المرسلين سيدنا ومولانا أبي القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين سيما بقية الله العظم روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفداء. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. Our ending is unknown, and that is what Allah wanted us to be aware of. How we are going to end, whether we are going to go to His pleasure in Jannah or we are going to be away from His mercy in hell, is unknown to us, how we will end. And that uncertainty and that factor of not knowing leads us to a certain sort of fear. And that fear of two things. Well, actually, the fear that is inclusive of two things. One is the pitfalls and the traps that lead a good person and throw him down into the hellfire. And the surges of faith that a person experiences that makes him go from being someone who is unexpected to be good to become great. Karbala is a compilation of both of these. You have people who were good and fell down because they were in traps, they were had those qualities that brought them down. And you have a group of people who were average people. They weren't expected to be good, but they ended up being great and achieving greatness. So the second part, obviously, about the surges, I'm not speaking about. But let's just, as I said, concentrate on the first part, which is the pitfalls. What to be aware of that can bring you down. Yesterday I mentioned a general point. Today I promised you I'll give a list. So without any further ado, I'm just going to go into the list of things that bring you down. That, for sure, if you have them, is going to be a reason for your faith to decline and your practice to be eventually finished and for you to end up with a sad ending. It is good for us to know this in order that we can be careful not to put our feet into such places, or if we have them, to make ourselves eradicate these sort of traps or these sort of pitfalls from within us. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Now, when we look at the list, first two points in the list, the first two pitfalls in the list have to do with character. It's a type of character that when we look at the history and we look at the pitfalls and we look at the people who went down, we see these characters prevalent amongst the people who fell down. The first sort of person, the first sort of pitfall is a character that you will notice, a character that stays away and tries to find a way to escape responsibility. A person, you will see some people, they just don't like responsibility. They don't want to take responsibility. When an obligation comes in front of them, they try to find a loophole to get out of it. They try to find a way that they can escape it. They're not the people who, for example, are looking to take responsibility. They are people who try to run away from responsibility. It's a type of characteristic that you'll see in a person like that. I mean, there are people that, for example, whenever they see that, you know what, if I go here, if I go to this place, these people will put a burden on me. any responsibility. You see that they shy away from that. And hence they never go close to those places or to those occasions where any sort of responsibility is put on them. And this is not just religious in any way terms of possible. You will see such people, for example, on the 15th of April when they have to file taxes. You know, you see that there are those people who are trying to look for loopholes to get out of paying any sort of taxes. Right? They are just like, you know what, I just want to see how I shouldn't pay any taxes. And that's, yes, one extreme. Right now there's another extreme also of people who go out of their way to volunteer to pay more taxes. Right? The issue is that there's a reason there's taxes. There's a reason that you have this in order that those services that are there can be provided for you, whatever it is. The issue is that people who evade that, who want to get away from that, it's a type of character. It's a type of characteristic in a person. This is a thing that happened with a lot of people. People who try to avoid responsibility, they never put themselves in a situation where they have to take a responsibility. And such people, whenever there is a call for them to do something or sacrifice something, they're not looking to actually do it, they're trying to escape it. These, for example, are the people who, when there is a Q&A, their line of questioning is like this: is this halal for me? Right? Now, when they ask, is this halal for me? And obviously it's about something that is, you can say, absurd or crazy or something that is not usual, like tattoos. You know, are tattoos halal? You know, now the issue is that, I mean, whether it's halal or not, that's not the issue. You know, why are you asking this? What's the purpose behind it? Right? What the issue is that, or, for example, is music halal? Right? Sometimes these questions can be loaded. And if you answer them just like they're asking, then you get into trouble because they'll have a misunderstanding of them. And what they're trying to do is trying to find a loophole. And this is their patent question that they will ask at every Q&A that you go to. You know? So, for example, you know, what you know, we did is that we have, for example, frequently asked questions, right? Made a website and answered them, and we did, but we should, that, you know what, no to all these, right? If you have any other question, go ahead and ask, and then the Q&A ends, right? Because there's no other question. They're just trying to escape from these things, right? They want to evade these things. And this is usually how people approach that. Now, someone who is really want a different type of character, and I want you to just judge this, see the difference between the two characters. Someone was saying, is this halal for me? As opposed to someone saying, would Rasulullah do such a thing? You know? I mean, is this the best thing for me? Now, when you ask that, the answer is completely different. The answer is completely different, but what this question is revealing is your character type, your personality type. What sort of a person are you? Are you that person who runs away or is looking for a loophole to get out of responsibility, or you are a person who's trying to find his responsibility, who's trying to find what he has to do? There's a difference. These people who run away from responsibilities really are the ones who end up opposing the truth eventually. They might be Shia, they might be Mu'mineen, they might be believers, but eventually Allah is going to put them in that task, reveal that inside out, and when the truth in the battlefield does come, where they have to make a decision, they will end up on the wrong side. They ended up on the wrong side. AKA people of Kufa who wrote letters to Imam Hussein. You know, there was a time when everyone was writing letters to Imam Hussein, and it became a fashion. So people went along with it and wrote letters. And then when actually Imam Hussein did come, they said, you know what? We put ourselves into trouble here, right? Now they have to own up to it. Now they have to face up to it. So what happened? Now they're trying to look for loopholes to get out of it. They're trying to justify, you know? And we're not talking about, you know, the Tom, Dick, and Harrys or the average people. We're talking about prominent figures in the Shia world at that time. A person by the name of Suleiman. He was like the, you could say the marja in Kufa. The leader of the Shias, the most knowledgeable person. What happened with these person? They, for example, looked at that, and when Imam Hussein actually sent a responsibility on them and a response to their letter of invitation, how did he do it? He sent Muslim ibn Aqil. He said, all right, here's your burden now. Here's what you asked for now. And as soon as Muslim ibn Aqil came there, these people refused to help him, refused to be with him, saying that you are not masoom, Imam Hussein is masoom, and we only follow masoom imams. You're not masoom, right? Why should we listen to you? Why should we follow you? You're not an imam. Imam Hussein, yeah, he's something else. When he comes, inshallah, we'll support him. We'll be there for him. And based on that, what happened? They refused to help, justifying their actions. Why did they do that? Because that character type, that you are not an alim for trying to find your responsibility, you are an alim to escape your responsibilities. And this is where they ended up. And it goes a long way. Goes a long way. Even people in that group who went there with them. And I'll explain in the next character type and you'll see that. Remember this example, and I'll give you the other example from the same example in the next group of people. Now, second, I want to go through this fast. Each of these can be explained in, you know, many speeches. Each of these things can be explained in detail, right? But I just want to go through the list today so that we get through most of the points, right? So at least, you know, that will be helpful. And inshallah, if ever a time comes, you know, you can start thinking and learning and understanding how this works. Second group of people are people who, when the truth comes to them and they hear the truth, they don't accept it in time. They unnecessarily delay accepting it. You know, you'll see some people, okay, you know this is right. Why aren't you accepting it? Well, let me see. It is an offshoot from the same first one. Well, let's see, you know. I really want to see. Do some more research. Okay, go ahead. You know, but how long does it take for you to do research? Do you actually know that this is right? If you know it, why don't you just submit to it? Why don't you accept it? Now, what happens with such people is that when you delay accepting the truth, when you delay accepting the truth, now what happens is that even when you accept it, the truth is not useful for you anymore. It loses its effect. It doesn't have the effect anymore. You know, for example, you know this is right. Why aren't you accepting it? No, whatever, you know, I'll do some more research, I'll do this, this and that. But when you actually now come around and say, okay, I admit it's right. Now when you say it, now that truth is useless for you. That acceptance is useless for you, and that submission is useless for you. Why didn't you accept it in the first place? That means that you weren't impressed with the truth. You were subjected to accepting it because of circumstances. Because of circumstances, you were accepting it. That's what happens to many people who, for example, they know this is right. You don't have to explain that 1 + 1 = 2 all the time. I mean, if you are explaining 1 + 1 = 2 to someone for many years, then either you are retarded or he is retarded. I mean, really, why can't you understand this? Why can't you accept it? Why aren't you accepting it? So what happened is that these people don't accept it. When you look at these people, they didn't accept the truth when it came to them. You know, they took their time. They'll say, oh, you know what, we'll wait for Imam Hussein. You know what happens when you wait for Imam Hussein? Or you're waiting and not accepting and submitting to the truth that's there right now? Then you know what, even when Imam Hussein comes, it is useless for you. It is useless for you. You will not be with him. Allah will make it such that you're not with him. Allah will make your life such that you're not with him. That's the way it is. People who, for example, who did not accept Muslim ibn Aqil, deferred it to Imam Hussein, Allah did not allow them to be with Imam Hussein also. They didn't come out to support Imam Hussein. Imam Hussein was killed. In fact, these were the first people who came after Imam Hussein was killed to see Imam Hussein. They came out there also. It was around the same time that Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari also came. Around the same time. They came there also, they saw Imam Hussein's grave there and this and that. They started crying and all these things. And they vowed that they were going to get the revenge for Imam Hussein. So, they did. And, you know, they went out and fought. You know that. They were called Tawabin. These Tawabun, you know, they went out and fought that army which killed Imam Hussein, right? And most, and a lot of them died, but then some of them remained alive. Now those people who remained alive, they wanted the revenge for Imam Hussein. Remember this. They wanted that. Now what happened is that they went to fight, but it didn't work there. Now their chance came to seek revenge for Imam Hussein through Mukhtar. When Mukhtar came into power, and the whole purpose of him establishing power was to go after those criminals who killed Imam Hussein and bring them to justice, these people had the chance to support Khurmala, meaning Mukhtar. They had the chance to support Mukhtar. Now what did they do? At that time, you know what happened? They opposed Mukhtar. They opposed Mukhtar. They ended up on the other side. They fought against him under the flag and the leadership of Shimr. They went in the leadership of Shimr to fight against Mukhtar. That's how much they hated Mukhtar. Why? Friends, Allah will make it such that you don't accept the truth now. Why did you take so long? Why did you take so long? These are things that really are traps for us. When we have a character type like that, then we need to look at that. If we see something as right, accept it. Submit to it. Okay, this is right. You're right. Why am I trying to differ? Why am I saying no when I know this is right? When my heart believes this is right, why am I saying no? Submit to it fast. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
You know, some people have a third thing. Some people have a character type where they overthink. You know, thinking is good. Overthinking is bad. It's the same as, you can say, an offshoot of the second one. There are people who, for example, overthink something. You know, really, let me really go and beat the horse and make sure that it's right and all these things. What happens is that when such people, they end up trying to make a decision between right and wrong, you will see that eventually they will decide wrong. They can't decide for the right. When the stakes are raised higher. And Allah does raise the stakes higher. See, Allah is the one who makes it harder for you. He puts in something in your test, like an added, you know, spice, you know, that, you know, you're like, where did that come from, you know? It happens, and Allah does it. And He does it in order to raise the stakes. Why? Because this testing has to be done, that which is hidden inside of you has to come out. He does that. like for example, in the time of Musa, you know, and the golden cow, you know that golden cow thing, right? When the golden cow was used to misguide the people, after all of that, right, Musa, when he spoke with Allah the next time, he asked Allah, Allah, there's one confusion I still have. I understand about the golden calf, I understand about Samiri, I understand about the invitation, and all these things, right? But you know, there's one thing I didn't understand in all of this, right? Samiri invited them, there was a golden calf, it was looking impressive and all these things, but that cow was making a noise. It was making an actual noise that, you know, impressed the people more. And that's why people went there into shirk, idolatry. I mean, I understand everything, but I don't understand that noise. Where did that noise come from? Where did that sound come from? So Allah's reply was that, oh, that was me. I made that noise. Why did you make that noise? To raise the stakes. To raise the stakes, you know? I mean, you can't have a test that's easy. You got to go through some rigorous testing. Right? Allah does that. He will raise your test and He will add ingredients in there where now it really becomes hard. Allah wants to see. So now what happened is that this is the same way. For example, I'll give an example in history so you understand this, right? Muawiyah approached this one sheikh, Alim, and he wanted him to give a bad label to Imam Ali. And he came to him and said, listen, I want you to say that this one particular ayat in the Quran, and this ayat is this, right? وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يُعْجِبُكَ قَوْلُهُ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيُشْهِدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا فِي قَلْبِهِ وَهُوَ أَلَدُّ الْخِصَامِ. He says, and amongst men you will see someone who when he speaks about the dunya, he is so great. His speech is so great. When you listen to him, he's mesmerizing in his speech. When he gives a speech and a khutbah, it's so great that he mesmerizes you. But then what happens? Yeah, Allah knows what's in his heart. And he is the most violent of enemies. His speech is great, but this guy is an enemy. He says, say that this ayat is about Imam Ali. And say this ayat to the people. Just say, oh, Allah revealed this ayat for Imam Ali. Just say that. And so, this guy, Alim, right? And he's learned. He says, this is crazy. What are you talking about? It's not about Imam Ali. It's not about Imam Ali. Muawiyah said, 100,000. But no one will believe it. No one will believe it. 200,000. Listen, you know, even if I say it, right, it won't be accepted by people. People know that this is not Ali and all these things. You listen, Muawiyah, don't worry about it. 300,000. Like, listen, you know, I mean, it's not that easy. You don't understand how difficult this is, you know, for us to do all these things. 400,000, okay. You know, done deal, right? 400,000, he agreed. 400,000 dirham, I will give you, and you say this ayat is about Imam Ali. And then Muawiyah said, and while you're doing that, say the ayat after that, the next ayat, is about Ibn Muljim. The one that's after that ayat, say that ayat is about Ibn Muljim. What is that ayat? وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْرِ نَفْسُهُ ابْتَغَاءَ مَرَضَاتِ اللَّهِ. That amongst men is someone who gives his life to seek the pleasure of Allah. Say, this is about Ibn Muljam. Now this guy, you know, I mean, he accepted that also right away without charging any more money. So this one was free, right? He got, so Muawiyah got lucky, two for the price of one, right? Lucky, he said, the second one I'll add in for free, all right? since you made a good deal on the first one. He just raised the stakes, and you see, he knows this is wrong what he's doing. But when the stakes are raised a little bit higher, you see, then everything starts to shake. This is a character type. What is the price on your head? On your faith? What is the price on your faith? Do you have a price? Have you tested it? Have you seen that if we raise the price, it will be done? You know, people really don't need a big price for it. A green card is enough nowadays. Right? They'll make a deal. All right, give me a green card, we make a deal. All right, we'll get it all done for you. Don't worry. Right? We'll get it done. That's it. Right? And this is the way it is. I mean, you know, they are ready to take off the alam of Abbas and put in the stars and stripes, you know, and, you know, bow down before that. They're ready for that. I mean, really look at it. Why is that? Why are you doing this? You know, I mean, I went to one center, you know, and I saw, you know, the flag up there. I said, what's the flag doing up there? And this was after 9/11, right? You know, they said, oh, Morana, you know, things are tense around here. So we have the flag up there for protection. For protection? You know, we got the flag up there for protection. I thought we used Ayatul Kursi. What happened to good old Ayatul Kursi? That's not working anymore. Really? I mean, come on. What's wrong with us? You know, that's it? That's all was needed to change you all from here to there? You know, why don't you put a big Ayatul Kursi up there, you know, and say that, you know, Allah said use this for protection. I mean, really, it happens. Simple things happen like that. When you look at that, we need to see, is there a price on our head? And if there is, then Allah is going to post that price on for us. He will offer it. Allah will offer it to us. He said, I will offer this money. Sell your faith. I'll give it to you. And it's not Muawiyah that's given. Allah will give it to you. He will say, I want to see how, because this has to come out. You are going to sell your faith. I want you to sell it. Go ahead. Sell it, so that at least you are known. At least you know who you are. This is what's important. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
All right, the fourth thing on the list, right? And I'm just going through the list, right? And now I won't explain a lot, just a little bit, all right? That's it. The fourth thing on the list is that brings a person down and destroys his faith eventually and makes him an enemy of the imam is reputation. Is reputation. You know, whatever you call it in language, izzat. That is a dangerous killer. Reputation. People, you know, they have a reputation that they think they have for themselves of being good, being muttaqi, being pious, being religious, you know, whatever, you know. They have this reputation for being that, and you know what, now they have to preserve that. They have to hold that to make sure that their reputation is kept up. Now whatever they do is not to please Allah, it is to maintain their reputation. I have to go to the masjid first. Why? Everyone knows I come first. Really? What's happening here? Really? Why? Why? Relax, don't go. What'll happen? You see, again, this reputation that's built, we need to see, am I doing the things that I do to keep my reputation up? As a mu'min, as whatever, this reputation is a killer. When you have that izzat and that idea about yourself, whatever image you made of yourself, when you keep that image in your heart, now what happened is that you are soon going to forget about Allah, forget about Imam Hussein and everything. It's all about your reputation. It's my majlis, we have to do the biryani. Why? For the past 5 years, we are doing biryani. Everyone expects biryani. We cannot lower the standards. but we don't have money for it. It doesn't matter, you know? We won't expect, and we have to keep the expectations of the people. It's a matter of our reputation. You're not doing this majlis for Imam Hussein. Now you're doing it for your reputation, for your image that you created for yourself. And now what happens? All your Islam is based on that. Every practice that you do ends up like that, and Allah will make it such. He wants it to come out. He will make it such. He will give you a more reputation also. He will increase your izzat and your name in such a way that, you know, you will feel better. And you think by feeling better, you are a better mu'min. You are a better practicing Muslim. What happens? You are now being fooled, and you are being deceived by your own self of this image that you have created for yourself to now turn away from Imam Hussein and everything. Really, many people, you know, I mean, this is how it happens. That reputation ends up you deciding to now be used for killing Imam Hussein. Why did Ibn Ziyad approach Umar ibn Sa'd to kill Imam Hussein? And friends, ordering the killing of Imam Hussein was not an easy thing, especially in Kufa. Imam Ali ruled in Kufa. Imam Hussein lived in Kufa. People know him. People know him. Imam Hussein himself is such a loving person. People loved him also. No one's going to just accept that. They know who Hussein is. They understood who Hussein is. No one's going to just turn around and do something like that. You know, of all the people that were there, no one could have taken this role. No one could have taken this role but Umar ibn Sa'd. Why? Because Umar ibn Sa'd had built a reputation of being a non-political person. Umar ibn Sa'd was a person who never took sides with anyone. Always kept neutral in every conflict and every battle. When he kept himself neutral in every battle, he built a reputation, mashallah, Sharif. He is very Sharif. Very good guy. Never takes sides, never is involved in politics. Really good guy. Really good guy. People respected his view because he never took sides. He built a reputation for himself. Ibn Ziyad needed that reputation to kill Imam Hussein. He needed someone who has a reputation that people can say, oh, if Umar ibn Sa'd is going against Hussein, so you know what? There is truth to this. Because he never takes side. He's never involved in politics. There must be a religious truth to this. There must be something right about this that he is taking that role. People who build images for themselves end up making that decision that Umar ibn Sa'd did. Because shaitan, leave shaitan, Allah will put him in that situation where you are going to be approached. Oh, so now you build this reputation? Hey, listen, we need you to fight against the truth. Can you use your reputation for that? Use it. And he's going to take it. This, my friend, is how it becomes a killer. Umar ibn Sa'd ended up being the leader of the army because of the great reputation he had of a neutral person who does not involve himself in politics, he doesn't take any sides, and everyone had such a great impression of him that when he stood up against Hussein, many people decided to stand up against Hussein because of his presence. Because of his presence. This is a killer reputation. We need to really see, are we doing things, the things that we do for reputation, or are we doing this for actually Allah Himself? Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Okay. The next item on the list of things that will destroy you, I mentioned it yesterday, but like I said, I'll mention specific things today, right? Let me just mention it. Arrogance. But arrogance in relationship to what, you know? arrogance in relationship to the truth. The arrogance we are talking that destroys you is an ego that we have that we are right and others are wrong. I'm on the right ideology and others are on the wrong ideology. One of the things that destroy a mu'min is that when he becomes a mu'min, the first thing that shaitan puts in his mind is that you are right and others are wrong. And the minute you start to see yourself as being right and others are wrong is your decline from the truth. It's like you just reached over here and you just blew your bubble. And now you're going down. Why did you do that for? Why did you even look back at others? See, when you're going towards Allah, one of the things always understand, when you are climbing, you know, and it's a rule of climbing, when you are climbing, don't look down. Right? Don't look down. Right? Because it makes you feel real high. It makes you feel real high. Just keep on looking up and you will feel that you have a long way to go. When a person goes towards Allah, the worst mistake that he can make is when he looks back at those who are behind him. The minute he looks back at those who are behind him, that's when he starts getting that high, that ego high. He looks back at them and says, oh man, these people are nothing. They are ignorant. You know, they are fools. They are this, they are that. All of that, it's a high, it's an ego high. This is a major mistake that mu'mineen make. Why are you even looking back? Just keep on looking at Allah. Keep on looking up. Because the more you are going to look up, the more you'll know how far you have to go. The minute you look back, then you say, MashaAllah, look at me, I reached so far. Wow, I did all of this, I came this far. That's exactly the trap that you fall in. And when you have that trap, it is going to make you go down. These are traps that we are talking about. And I said, really, explanation can be a lot for this, but I want you to understand this, you know, ego in relationship to truth, that I am on the truth, that's the idea behind it. And that's how a person destroys himself. Right? When we keep looking at Allah and Ahlul Bayt, then we'll know how, wow, I have so much to go. I am so far behind. All of this I'm saying is according to hadith. I'm not mentioning the hadith because obviously it's going to take a lot of time to mention each and every hadith. Right? That the Imams have said, you know, keep looking towards what's higher than you, not what's lower than you. Keep looking up because of this. Why? Because the more you look up, the more you know how poor you are. And the more you look down, you will start seeing yourself as rich. And that is going to be your destruction. So this is why that ego comes in, when you think that I am right and others are wrong. Why are you even looking at others that are being wrong? Don't even look at them. Just look at yourself and see, am I right or are Ahlul Bayt right? No, they're still right. I'm wrong. Let me go further. Right? Let me go further. And then look up again at them, and they'll still be on top of you. And they'll still be on top of you. There'll never be a time when you are going to get equal to Ahlul Bayt. So just keep looking at them, and then you'll climb more. And climb more. This is the idea behind ego. Ego in relationship to truth is a trap that leads to destruction. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
All right, you know, again, as I said, you know, a lot of things happen. Okay, one trap that has happened is love of status. Love of maqam, hubbul maqam, it says. Hubbul maqam is love of being someone. Right? That I want to be this. Now, just going back to that hadith I mentioned yesterday regarding the hadith that where the Imam says, you know, that don't be fooled by a person who doesn't sin. right? And I left the last line open. I said, I'll give the example today of that. It's over here, right? Meaning that the Imam has said, right, that don't be fooled by people who don't sin as being good, because sometimes people sin because they're incompetent. They don't know how to sin. Or if they know how to sin, they are just not that smart enough to sin. Or even if they're smart enough to sin, maybe their nafs is involved. Maybe their nafs is involved, and because their nafs, and that nafs that they have, the lower desires they have, is not letting them sin. And this place, Imam gave an example. He says, like hubbe maqam, like a person whose nafs wants, is in love with being someone. I want to be the president, right? I want to be, you know, up there, king, whatever it is. I want that maqam. I want that status. I want that name, that title. Now what happened is that because your nafs wants that title, it will not let you do anything wrong that will hurt that goal. It will not let you do anything wrong to hurt that goal that's in your sight. So yes, these little things I'm not going to get involved in. I'm not going to go and drink. Why? Because you know what? I want the status. And if I go there, and if people know me like that, they're not going to vote for me. I want to keep myself clean so that I can reach there. That's the reason a person is not sinning. Look at that and see if that's the case behind it. Hubbe maqam, or wanting status, really is not how big it is. It could be very small also. It's still a status. Someone just wants to be, you know, president of something small, you know. I mean, you'll see, you know, for example, some people, you know, are so adamant and passionate about being the president of the HOA, knowing that everyone hates the president of the HOA. You know? But they are so adamant, it's like, for example, their life's passion for it. You know, I mean, they're like, you know, this is my thing, you know, in life. It's not important. Take it easy. You know, I mean, nowadays, you know, when you go, for example, in Iran and Iraq for ziyarat and all that, you know, they have modern bathrooms there, even with Western toilets, right? In the old days, when you used to go to the bathrooms there, there used to be a hole in the ground, right? Well, those places like that. And, you know, they used to have the public bathrooms there. And in the public bathrooms, what used to happen is that, you know, there always used to be a caretaker who would look after the public, you know, taking care of it, cleaning it. And his job was also to have the lotas, you know, those lotas that were there. He would fill the lotas up and line them up for people to take, you know. So, you know, that everyone just takes the lota, uses, and brings it back. That's how it used to happen in the old days, in the public bathrooms. So, you know, person comes over there and, you know, wants to take a lota, grabs one, is, no, not that one, take that one. You know, probably something wrong with this, leaking, whatever it is. He goes and uses and come back. He says, by the way, I'm curious, you know. You know, I mean, is there something wrong with this one? You know, I was taking that one randomly, but you said don't take that one and take the other one over there, right? Is there something wrong with that one? Why did you stop me from taking that one? And the guy just looked at him and said, because I'm in charge. I'm the boss. You know. You know, a lot of people become lota kings. You know? They become that. Like, you know, I am the master of this, I don't know, 2 feet right here, this parking space right here. It's mine. I mean, really. The issue that, oh, this love of this status, you see, this, it doesn't have to be big, even if it's small, but that love for being in charge of that is what makes a person enter into a downfall in faith. People fall down because of status, just little things like that. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
All right, next item on the list, and inshallah, I'm going to go through this in the next 5 minutes, I guess, and that's it, right? And see how much we're able to cover, right? Next item on the list is hero worship. Hero worship is another pitfall that a lot of people are unaware of. You know, sometimes what happens is that people create an image of someone as their hero, as their leader, as their, you know, whole and soul. And so now, once they create that hero image of someone, what happens is that eventually you stop scrutinizing what is being said and just take anything that comes from your leader. Without starting to think for yourself. Without even trying to pay attention to what is being said. You just start thinking. Why? Because you created an image of that. And because you created that image of this hero or this hero worship that you have, now you don't pay attention to what is being said. You pay attention to who's saying it. Oh, is he saying it? It must be right. Where did that come from? And the advice of Imam Ali is what? See what is being said, not who's saying it. Always see what is being said and scrutinize that before accepting it. Think for yourself before accepting it. If you just create a hero, an idol, that now whatever he says, what comes out of him is going to be right, then what happens is that you fall into that trap of one day listening to batil and accepting what it says without any question. Imam Ali alayhi salam,
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad,
in one of the sermons he gave in the Masjid of Kufa, he used to give the sermons there, he pointed out to the crowd, he says, I really don't like you as an audience. I don't like you as an audience. If I say that, don't invite him next year. You know, the opposition group will say, invite him back. But what happens is this, right? Let's say, but Imam Ali said it, right? He says, I don't like you as an audience. Why? He says, because the only reason you listen to me is because I'm sitting on the minbar. I'm sitting on the minbar. That's why you're listening to me. So what that means is that anyone who'll come after me and sit on the minbar, he'll have the same position. He'll have the same position, right? Because your idea and your standard of right is anyone who sits on that minbar. That's your standard. And so now what will happen is that if someone else who's false comes on the minbar, then you will say that, oh, it comes from the minbar, you know, Maulana is saying it. And then you just follow it. Just follow it. What are we doing? Right? Imam Ali is saying, that's not what I am. And this is not, that's not the audience I'm looking for. Even when I say it, I want you to think about it first. If you're not convinced, ask me questions to get convinced. Don't just accept what I'm saying. Just because I'm on the minbar, this is the wrong standard. Nowadays, for example, anyone who wears an imamah and whatever he says, that's it. Accept it. Where did that standard come from? Of being right and wrong. That's not a standard. The standard that Ahlul Bayt wanted us to have is to have an educated view on things. Scrutinize things, analyze things for yourself, know why Ahlul Bayt are right. What they're saying is right. Understand their deen so that you don't get fooled by someone who comes here in the same dress or on the same member and starts speaking rubbish. At least you're able to scrutinize that. Think about it. This is how Ahlul Bayt wanted us to be. This is why this hero worship of creating an image of someone and whatever he says. You know, I remember in my class in the house, all right, it's a logic class, has nothing to do with any logic, right? Just logic. We had a logic class going on, and the teacher is explaining something, whatever, I can't remember what it was. But I do remember that, you know, he said that, you know, he gave an example of something, he said, this is, and that, right? And I remember one of the students, right, who got up, and he, you know, questioned him. He questioned him and said, you know, but Imam Khomeini says this. And he says, yes, Imam Khomeini says that, but I beg to differ. You're going against Imam Khomeini. What are you talking about? Right? This is knowledge. You know, knowledge can't be dictated by one person's opinion. You're in the Hausa. You want to follow that, go on the ground in the battlefield, and that's where you follow rules. In the Hausa, every opinion counts. Every view counts. You can't just make an image and say, no, whatever he says right, everyone else is wrong. This is the wrong way to approach education and knowledge. Otherwise, it's not education anymore, it's indoctrination. And knowledge is not about that. Ahlul Bayt are saying that, listen, whenever we say something being masoom, you analyze it. But you are the masoom imam. Why? Because that's the audience that we want, who are going to become our true Shias. And it will protect you from falling down and being ending up in the hands of batil. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Okay, there's a lot of other list over here. I'm just going to, well, I guess one more, all right? Send us salawats.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
You know, same as that, right? Again, simple-mindedness is another pitfall. Simple-mindedness means that a person just looks at the superficial side of things without taking time to go deeper in understanding things in a much more deeper way. He just looks at the outward and says, this is it, and makes a judgment on that without even looking inside of it to see what's going on. People are like that. They end up being naive. And when you look at them, their views and how they view things, they fall prey to conspiracy theories. They become the honey boo-boos of the community. You know, people are just like, you know, and you talk to them and say, wait a minute, there are layers of things behind it. Let's look deeply into it. They are unable to. And this is a trap that people have. The trap they fall into. This is dangerous because being simple-minded is dangerous. How do you get rid of that? Be around people who are deep thinkers. When you are around people who are deep thinkers, then you will learn how thinking is done. There's a place in Nahjul Balagha, again, I don't have time to explain all of this, place in Nahjul Balagha where Imam Ali alayhi salam says regarding adalat, regarding justice, he says that one of the pillars of justice is having less knowledge. Less knowledge. Someone, you know, like if you want to be just, have less knowledge, not more knowledge. If you have more knowledge, then you won't be just. If you have less knowledge, you will be just. One condition though. He says, less knowledge that is deep. Not a lot of knowledge that is shallow. I know 1,000 hadiths. How deep did you go in those hadiths? You know, you put your feet in there, it goes only ankle deep. Your understanding of it is nothing. I can say 100 ayat right now. How deep is your understanding about those ayat? No one ayat, but with deep understanding. This leads to justice and adl. I'm not having a lot of knowledge. I studied for 15 years. Okay, how deep is your understanding? How much depth have you gone into this understanding? Just reading hadith after hadith after hadith, you know? What's the use of that? That's like a parrot, you know, I studied all these things, I memorized all these things. Imam saying, no, I want you to go deeply into things. Even if that knowledge is less, but know it well, as opposed to having a lot of knowledge and not knowing it well. Really, depth is like that, my friends. So you, for example, whatever hadith you know, how well do you know it? How much have you gone into it? How much have you thought about it? Use your mind to think about it, go deeply into it, and then you will come to see what's right and wrong. Because when someone is simple-minded, he ends up on the wrong side. They always make mistakes, knowing what's right and what's wrong, because they never looked at things deeply. They just went on the superficial. That's why many people can't make the decision if Imam Ali is right or if Muawiyah is right. Really, you can't make a decision between Ali and Muawiyah? You know? On one side you have Imam Ali, and we all know who Imam Ali is. And on the other side you have Muawiyah, who has broken every rule in the Quran except for wasting food. He was fat, you know. And you have this guy over here, and you're comparing these two people together? I mean, you can't decide between these two? Really? That's how sad you are? That's how not deep you're going? This is the problem, my friends. We need to be deep in our understanding. You don't need to go to the house for 15 years for that. Right? Whatever little you have, use your mind and think about it. Think deeply about it. Thinking is so important that it says that it is better than a lifetime of ibadat. 1 hour of thinking is greater than 100 years of ibadat. Just 1 hour of thinking, think about it. That's how faith grows also. That's one of the surges of faith, thinking. Right? It's one of the surges of faith. But that's it, my friends, for today, all right? We did this. I don't want to go any further because the list goes on. But you get the idea of the relevant things that I want to get across as pitfalls that will destroy your faith. Two men were present on the night of Ashura, and they were going around, two friends, looking for the truth. And they said, you know what? We want to go and actually see, you know, ourselves. You know, they decided, we want to see with our own eyes, study with our own eyes, and then decide which side is right, which side is wrong. They wanted to do that. So they came, they went to one camp, saw what was going on there, saw the environment, saw everything there, studied that, and then they came to the tents of Imam Hussein. And when they came to the tents of Imam Hussein, they heard the Quran being recited in a way that they never heard before. It was as if the Quran was actually coming to life. This is how they were looking at it, as if this is alive. Quran is alive here. Do you see how they're reading it? Every tent they went to in Imam Hussein's camp, they heard the Quran being recited. From every tent they're looking, every tent is giving a different life to the Quran. They looked at that. He said, and then they told themselves, how can this be wrong? How can this be wrong? You know, and then they wanted to meet Hussein ibn Ali, you know, they were like talking with themselves, learning, analyzing. They didn't just say, okay, you know what, we're just going to go over here. No, they wanted to see themselves. You see, what kind of followers you want? What kind of follower you want to be with? Even if it's Ahlul Bayt here, I want to study it myself so that I can know. They studied Imam Hussein, they studied his camp, and then they wanted to stay there. So what happened is that as they were outside the tents of Imam Hussein, they heard a noise. Outside the tent, they heard a noise that came around there. And they turned around to see, you know, afraid, who's out there? Just away from the tents, who's out there? So they said, who is it? They shouted out to see, you know, it was right close to them, behind them. They said, who is it? So they turned around and the answer came, I am Hussein ibn Ali. And they came to Imam Hussein and said, what are you doing out here? He said, what are you doing out here? Yeah, they still haven't decided yet, right? They want to decide. Now they actually meet Imam Hussein. They want to decide now. What's that? They asked him, what are you doing here? Imam Hussein said that tomorrow my children are going to become yatim. And they will be driven from these tents. And they will be running around in these tents. I'm just cleaning the brush here and these thorns. I don't want them to get hurt. I don't want them to get hurt. You know, their hearts just melted in front of Hussein. Hussein, you're thinking about your children. These little kids, you're thinking that far. Right then and there, they decided. They decided that we want to be with you. Imagine that if we studied Ahlul Bayt, we studied about our Imam, and we come to the Imam, and we meet him, and we say, we want to be with you. Really, this is their position now. They really want to be with Imam Hussein. So they said, we want to be with you. If you are going to die tomorrow, we want to die with you. Imam Hussein looked at them. You know what Imam Hussein said? He says, do you see that light far away from here? He showed them a certain light there. He says, do you see that light far away from here over there? They said, yes, we see that light. He says, go on over there. Go there. Go there and you'll be safe. Nothing will happen to you. You'll be safe. Go there. They just looked at Hussein. He said, Hussein, are you trying to kick us away from here? Are you trying to make us go away from here? We want to be with you. We decided to be with you. Imam Hussein, he says, are you sure you want to be with me? Are you sure you want to die tomorrow? They said, yes, we are sure. He says, so be it. Don't worry, be it. Stay here in the camp and you will have your chance tomorrow. To fulfill your goal, you will have your chance tomorrow. But tonight, I have to go and spend time with my sister Zainab. I'll go and spend time with her. So Imam Hussein went to the tent of Bibi Zainab. These two men followed Imam Hussein, escorted him to the tent. Imam Hussein went inside. Now as soon as Imam Hussein went inside, they overheard. They overheard the conversation between Bibi Zainab and Imam Hussein. They overheard the conversation. And Bibi Zainab, they heard her speak to Imam Hussein and ask Imam Hussein a question. He says, are you sure about these companions that they will not abandon you? Hussein, are you sure they're not going to run away? Zainab knows about companions who ran away from Imam Ali and Imam Hussein. She's asking Imam Hussein, are you sure they're not going to run away from you? When these two men heard that, they shuddered. They really shuddered. They didn't know what to do. So they came to Habib ibn Mazahir looking for him. Habib, you're reading the Quran here. You're all happy here. Don't you see what's going on? He says, why? What's going on? We have nothing to fear. We have nothing to fear. We are with Hussein. We have nothing to fear. He says, no, we just came from the tent of Zainab, and Zainab has doubt in you all. She has doubt that we will run away from Hussein and abandon him. So Habib then called everyone together. He called everyone together and he said, come here, come here. We have to go and do this tonight. They said, what happened? And all of them came around. Even Abbas and Ali Akbar came seeing what's going on. And when they came, Habib told them, no, this meeting is not for you. You are our leaders. You go away. This is only for slaves. This is only for slaves. So these men, they came to the tent of Hussein and shouted out, Hussein, come out, we need to talk. Hussein came there and said, listen, we want to talk to Zainab, your sister. We want to talk to her. If you can allow us to talk to her, ask her to come behind the curtain there, behind the curtain of the tent, and we want to address her. Zainab came there, they addressed Zainab. This was the last time that there were men who gave respect to Zainab. Last time that Zainab was being given respect by anyone. And they told Zainab, and they started saying to Zainab that, Zainab, we are there for you, we are there for your brother. Call. When Imam Hussein heard them, Imam Hussein said to them, you know, listen to this, and then give condolences about Hussein. And you'll know what I mean. Imam Hussein said, okay, stop, don't say anything. They all stop saying it, right? You know why? Imam Hussein, he turns towards Zainab and says, Zainab, would you also bring Sakina here so she can listen? Bring my daughters here so they can listen also. Imagine what's going to happen tomorrow. My friend, Imam Hussein was so afraid. He was just so mesmerized as what's going to happen tomorrow after he dies. He knows exactly what's going to happen. But that fear of Imam Hussein, he asked the companions to testify before their daughter so at least they can sleep tonight, knowing that there are people to defend him. But when tomorrow came, Imam Hussein was gone and Imam Sajjad was woken up. Imam Sajjad just went through Ashura, but his test began after Ashura. Not only was it the physical pain, not only was it the mental pain, but the fact that everything Allah said that I didn't take from Hussein, Sajjad, I'm going to take from you. Hussein sacrificed lives. Sajjad, you will have to sacrifice your honor. I didn't take that from Hussein. They respected Hussein till the end. They did not go to the tents of Imam Hussein until he died. At least they gave him that respect. But when Imam Sajjad was woken up, when Imam Sajjad was woken up, now you see, he looks around and he sees Zainab and Umm Kulthum. Prisoners, hostages, taken like vagabonds. Imam Sajjad looks at this. And everywhere he goes, his head is bowed down. No matter where he goes. It was so bad that in Kufa, when he went to the Masjid, when he went to Kufa in front of Ibn Ziyad, you know how he went there? His head was bowed down. Someone came to Imam Sajjad afterwards and said to him, I saw you when you came there to Kufa and in front of Ibn Ziyad, but I was also there when Muslim Ibn Aqil came in front of Ibn Ziyad. But there was a difference. When Muslim Ibn Aqil came, he came like a lion, he came like a brave man, his head was held high and he was shouting at them and he was telling them that you all are cowards. But when I saw you come in, you were came like a coward with your head held down, your shoulders bowed down. Why? What was the difference? Imam Sajjad said, did you see that when Muslim Ibn Aqil came, he came alone? When I came with the daughters of Rasulullah. Oh, Imam Sajjad, what has made you bow down? Imam Sajjad, what has made you bow down? What made your head bow down? Imam Sajjad went from all places, his heart being broken in every step of the journey. He came so much. He went through so much that it said about Imam Sajjad that every time he would see a glass of water, Every time he would see a glass of water, he would look at that water. As soon as he looks at that water, he will cry so much that he will pass out. Sajjad, what are you looking at in that glass that makes you so horrified of that glass of water? Imam Sajjad went through that. After all that he went through, so many years passed now, all these years passed, it was so bad that every time it is said that in Medina when he came back, even after 30 years this incident happened, 30 years is a lifetime, after 30 years this incident happened, that when he was walking by the bazaar of Medina, the butchers there would hide the animals. He would hide the animals. People would ask them, why are you hiding these animals? Why are you hiding the meat? He says, because Sajjad is coming. Ibn Rasulullah is coming. He said, but why? Why do you hide from him? Every time he sees them, he always asks us, did you give water to them before you slaughtered them? They said, yes, we did. Yes, we did. Then he would turn to Karbala and said, you see, my father, they still give water to animals. Say, Allahu Ladin Salam. هي منقلب ينقلبون يا محمود بحق محمد يا علا بحق علي يا فاطر السماوات بحق يا محسن بحق ياسين قديم الحسن بحق حسين. Allah, give us the tawfiq to be on the right path. Give us the wisdom to understand your guidance. Hasten the reappearance of our Imam. Make us his helper when he comes. Allah, all the mu'mineen who are here, help them to cross the paths of hardships so that they can reach you and they can reach their Imam. Allah, make them such that Bibi Zahra can be proud of them. Wa akhir da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Matam Hussain.
Barbaad hui main, Zainab ko naraza ya Muharram ka mahina, barbaad hui.